Access for Everyone, breaking down digital barriers for people with disabilities. Topic 3, recommended practices and tips for digital accessibility.
In this video, Jessica and I will share some strategies that our team has learned in more than 10 years of investigating digital accessibility cases at the Office for Civil Rights in the U.S. Department of Education. While there is no one-size-fits-all approach to improving the accessibility of websites and other digital information, there are common strategies that schools have used successfully in making their digital information accessible.
First, have a plan. Establish your accessibility goals and benchmarks and determine how quickly you can meet them. You may want to convene a team as you do this, bringing together tech experts, procurement personnel, teachers, or even vendor representatives. Also, and very importantly, talk to people with disabilities and get their input on what barriers they experience when accessing your services, programs, or activities, and what they would like to see prioritized. Lisa Maria is blind and a mother of three, and she, like many parents, likes to stay involved in her children's education. She believes any implementation should include those with disabilities.
It might be accessible on paper, but when it comes time to actually using the product, get people with disabilities involved. We will tell you if it really, really works.
So, as you work toward your goals and benchmarks, talk to people with disabilities and make sure to keep up on current technology and your users' needs. After all, both may be changing as you do your work.
Second, evaluate your online programs and activities. How accessible are they? There are many automated website checking tools that can help catch accessibility barriers, but there are lots of things they won't catch accurately, if at all. So we strongly recommend your team also makes a regular practice of manual testing. What do we mean by manual testing? This involves checking for keyboard access, color contrast, document accessibility, caption accuracy, and validating your automated checker results to ensure the meaningfulness of alternative text and other text descriptions of images, field labels, and others. Here's how to start. Unplug your mouse and see if you can navigate to and activate everything on a web page by using only your keyboard in a logical sequence, and that you can tell where you are on the web page at all times. Use the tab, enter, spacebar, and arrow keys. If you can't get to something with the keyboard that you can get to with the mouse, or if you cannot tell where you are on the web page, that lets you know that there will be users with disabilities who won't be able to navigate the page. If there is another equally easy way for people with disabilities to get the same information or accomplish the same task, then that's okay under the law. But otherwise, it will be important to make some changes. We'll discuss how to do this later in the series.
Third, review the services, programs, and activities that are part of your online learning environment beyond your public-facing website, including course registration, online lectures, systems for turning in assignments and posting grades, and more. These may involve different personnel at your school. So think about ways for your technology staff and instructional staff to work together.
Fourth, as you work toward full digital accessibility, you can prioritize your remediation efforts to focus on the most important or impactful work first. For example, you might want to look first at web page templates, the framework used for many of your school's web pages. That way, as additional pages are built using those templates, many of the accessibility components are already built in. Or, focus on the online programs and activities that are used the most. As you set your priorities, have a system in place for individuals with disabilities to request that the specific content that they need can be made accessible right away. Keep working steadily, and you will build a digital school culture where everyone, with and without disabilities, can participate.
Lastly, provide training that is tailored to the needs of different staff. For example, instructors may get specific training on how to create accessible documents or how to create and edit captions for videos that are posted online. Information technology staff may need training to be sure they are familiar with what digital access requires and the technical work required to fulfill that responsibility. For those in your procurement or purchasing department, training can emphasize the importance of contracting with vendors that offer accessible products.
We know it's important to you that all your students, parents, and community members have the access to learn and participate in your programs. Use these suggested approaches, share others, and reach out to us at ocr@ed.gov for additional support and help. And remember, as Lisa Maria has told us, we're trying to eliminate problems of inaccessibility.
If disability is considered in the beginning stages, you know, in the design stages, then this type of problem will exist a lot less. And educational sites, at least with images, would be a lot more accessible to more students.
This video was produced by the U.S. Department of Education Office for Civil Rights.
You can find us at ed.gov/OCR or email us at OCR@ED.gov.